These are voters in Wisconsin waiting to cast their ballot in the April primary election, despite being under stay-at-home orders during the coronavirus pandemic.
With a potential resurgence of the virus in the fall of 2020, many are questioning how they will vote in the November general election without jeopardizing their health. One solution?
Mail-in ballots.
Mail ballots.
Vote by mail.
Vote by mail.
Lawmakers are debating whether expanded absentee voting policies should be adopted in all 50 states.
It shouldn't be mail-in voting. It should be you go to a booth and you proudly display yourself.
So the real problem right now is public safety, and that people shouldn't have to choose between voting and their health. And we all know there's one solution, which is right out in front of us, and that is voting at home or voting by mail.
To understand the debate, first you have to understand what voting by mail looks like now. All states allow forms of voting by mail, but for some, it has limitations. Currently, 5 states have primarily mail-in elections. This includes Oregon, which was the first state to fully adopt the policy in 1998.
The states that have a culture and history of extensive use of vote by mail have enjoyed higher turnout. The states that extensively use vote by mail really like it because they think it's more convenient for voters. They think it is cheaper and easier to administer.
29 states have what is called no excuse absentee voting, which means that any voter can request a ballot to vote from home, which they can then mail in or drop off in a ballot box. The remaining 16 states, which you can see here in gray, allow for mail-in voting, but only with an excuse, like having a physical disability or being away on election day. Some states, such as New York, Maryland, and Georgia, have already opted to expand voting by mail because of the pandemic. Some lawmakers are arguing that absentee voting should be accessible and easy for all voters. Senators Amy Klobuchar and Ron Wyden have introduced the Natural Disaster and Emergency Ballot Act. The bill would expand early in-person voting and no-excuse vote-by-mail to all registered voters in every state, among other things.
So we don't know, as much as we'd like to, what will happen in November, but the safe bet is that this will still be around in some form and that we need to plan ahead and allow people to vote safely at home.
In March, Congress passed a $2.2 trillion coronavirus relief bill that included $400 million to address voting issues created by the pandemic. Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, is calling for more funds in the next stimulus.
It has been estimated by the Brennan Center that it would take about $2 billion to ensure that the appropriate policies can be in place in order to make sure that the November election goes off without a hitch.
For all Americans to have the full ability to vote by mail in the 2020 election, the policy will need to be included in legislation that is approved by Congress.
There's huge urgency to getting this bill done because the Secretary of States in each state need time to plan.
It will require significant resources for states to enact voting reforms less than 7 months before a presidential election. This includes hiring additional election staff and purchasing equipment such as high-speed ballot scanners and large orders of envelopes and postage. The Brennan Center estimates the total cost of postage to be between $413 and $593 million, while ballot drop boxes with security could cost an additional $117 to $165 million.
The states that extensively use vote by mail have a variety of security mechanisms. They start with voter rolls that they believe are clean because they have been doing a number of interactions with the voters and they're constantly updating the information that they get. They have mechanisms for tracking where the ballot is in the pipeline to ensure the chain of custody. They have non-discriminatory procedures for comparing signatures.
Opponents of mail-in voting argue that it increases the risk of fraud and that it's not a reliable way to cast a ballot.
The most secure way to do an election where people have the most confidence in the election is to have people go to their assigned polling place on election day and vote.
They say that voting early also encourages voters to cast their ballots before having all of the information from a campaign. While researchers have found cases of fraud, evidence shows that overall it's rare. The debate over vote by mail doesn't always follow party lines. Some Republican governors are pushing for temporary voting by mail just during the coronavirus pandemic. But for some states, the only way to allow absentee voting for all voters would be to change the state constitution. Experts point out that it may not be the best option for everyone, and that ensuring the safety of voters will require multiple methods.
There are going to be some communities that have terrible mail service, and it would be inappropriate to expect them to vote by mail when they don't trust the mail.
It's not one size fits all. We want to, as a country, to move to mail-in balloting, but we know that people with disabilities, many of them, can't vote by mail. You'll have people that do want to vote at the polls for some reason, or don't have their ballot didn't arrive. All kinds of things can happen. So you don't want to have them lose that right.